Good morning. We begin with a development on the police taser incident in Cooma in regional New South Wales. Moments ago, New South Wales police suspended the officer who fired the taser at 95-year-old Claire Noland, who is now receiving end-of-life care in Cooma Hospital. The 33-year-old constable has been stood down from duty with pay and police continue to investigate. A 24-year-old man has been shot dead in a suspected gangland attack in Sydney's west. James Wilson is in Elizabeth Hills for us this morning. James, what more do we know?
Well, Lizzie, the victim's been identified as 24-year-old Marvin O'Reilly. He is a barber and a university student from Elizabeth Hills. He was gunned down as he hopped into his own car in the driveway of his home behind me. It's understood that Marvin's mother and younger sister were inside the home when this happened. They just arrived back from the school pickup when the shots rang out. They ran out, but unfortunately, Marvin could not be revived. We've seen a number of his family members return back here to the scene this morning, including Marvin's father, who is extremely distraught. According to family friends, he hasn't slept. He was at work when he heard the news, and all he wants to be back now is with his family. But of course, this remains a crime scene in Elizabeth Hills as police investigate exactly what happened. We spoke to this family friend a short time ago.
I'm very sad for him. All family sad. Quiet boy. Lovely boy. Yeah, it was very good.
Lizzie, right now, homicide detectives are really spread across three scenes in the local area. Here, where the gunman pounced on Marvin waiting in a white Audi. From there, the Audi sped down the street. It's understood it actually collided, was T-boned by a vehicle as it sped away from the area behind me. That white Audi was burnt out in nearby Green Valley, where the gunman ran across a park. From there, it's understood the gunman then jumped into a black four-wheel drive. Now, that four-wheel drive was found burnt out a short time later in nearby Bonnie Heights. Of course, detectives are back on those scenes today, canvassing for CCTV to try and work out exactly where these gunmen have gone from there. We understand it's at least more than one or two people. Homicide detectives will be addressing the media at 1 p.m. We're trying to establish exactly why Marvin was targeted. According to Marvin's family, they have no idea why he could succumb to such a fate. He was a lovely young man and highly educated, and he's very missed here this morning. Lizzie.
James Wilson there for us in Western Sydney. The AFL world has been rocked by news of the resignation of three-time premiership winning Richmond coach Damien Hardwick. Brayden Ingram is live for us at club headquarters. Brayden, tell us, why is Hardwick stepping away from the game?
Well, Lizzie, quite simply, he says he's pushed every button he can, use all of the motivational tools in his arsenal, and the club now needs a new voice. Make no mistake, this is a massive bombshell. Really, no one saw it coming, but for Hardwick, he says it's been a decision at least a few weeks in the making. He said he kept questioning whether he was the right man for the job, and given he kept asking himself that question, he knew it was the right time to go. Of course, he's been here for 14 years. He'd been the AFL's current longest serving coach, the three premierships, leading them out of the doldrums and back to the powerhouse that they had been in the 70s and 80s. This was Damien Hardwick a short time ago.
I started to question myself and about what, you know, it was like to coach Richmond, and as soon as I started asking the question more, I started to understand what the answer was going to be. So the best thing for myself was to step aside. If I couldn't give 100%, there was no way I was going to coach this footy club.
Given how successful he's been, there'll be many questions now as to whether he'll pop up elsewhere, and really all 17 other clubs will probably be asking the question. But at this stage, he says he just needs a rest, and said that Dustin Martin, the superstar, suggested he goes to Ibiza and has a bit of a party. So that remains to be seen. He won't have a farewell game. Assistant coach Andrew McWalter, he's been here since 2014, and he'll take the reins as interim coach for the rest of the season while the Tigers search for Damien Hardwick's replacement. But there's no doubt it'll be a very big job to fill. He has been an amazing servant. Lizzie?
It will. Brayden Ingram there for us at Richmond HQ. A bus driver has been left shaken after a crane dropped its load onto the double-decker in Sydney's CBD this morning, damaging the roof and door. The bus is still operational and has been moved. Tens of thousands of people are expected to gather in Sydney tonight to welcome Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who's on a whirlwind trip to Australia. Let's go live now to federal politics reporter Fiona Whelan. Fee, what's on the agenda for the visiting PM?
Lizzie, the Indian PM will be centre stage in Sydney tonight before getting down to official business tomorrow with diplomatic talks. And Narendra Modi is expected to attract a big crowd while he's in Australia. This evening, around 20,000 supporters will attend a rally at Sydney Olympic Park, where the Indian Prime Minister will appear with Anthony Albanese. Now, the two leaders were side by side in India just a couple of months ago, receiving a rock star reception from a cricket crowd. But away from all of this public excitement, they do have serious reasons for wanting to build this relationship, and one of those is to counter the rise of China and its increasing assertiveness in the region. Here's the Defence Minister on that issue.
Yeah, we do have security anxieties in relation to China with the significant military build-up that we've seen. All of that is complex.
And the two Prime Ministers will now have something new to discuss when they meet for talks tomorrow. There's been a significant development in the region with the US and Papua New Guinea signing a security pact. So this happened after the US Secretary of State and the Indian Prime Minister visited PNG in recent days, holding talks with Pacific Island leaders, whom China has also been trying to strengthen ties with. Here's Antony Blinken.
The agreements that we've reached, the work that we're doing, is not about any other country. It's about our relationship with the Pacific Islands and the shared vision that we have for this region.
It secures our national interest to grow into becoming a robust economy in this part of the world as we live today and going forward.
Under the agreement, America's presence in the region will expand, and the Australian Defence Minister says that he welcomes that. Lizzie?
Fiona Whelan there for us. A 15-year-old boy has been charged over a smash and grab south of Brisbane. CCTV shows the group breaking into the Bars Scrub home last week, where the property owner's brother confronted them and was stabbed in the stomach. The group's getaway car then slammed through the front of the house as they sped off. Police are still hunting for the others involved. Victorian Treasurer Tim Pallas is now only hours away from delivering his ninth budget at a critical time for the state. It's expected to detail how Victoria will begin repaying its COVID debt, which has become increasingly expensive to service as interest rates continue to rise. Police in Melbourne are stepping up their hunt for a teenager who's wanted over a fatal stabbing in the city's west. 17-year-old Mayik Atom is believed to be involved in the stabbing death of a 16-year-old boy at a Sunshine train station. A major search is underway for the teenager, who hasn't been seen since it happened last Friday. The Nine Network has today announced it's secured the exclusive broadcast rights to the Paralympic Games in Paris 2024. The historic deal will see unrivalled coverage of the Games across Nine's television, radio, print, digital and streaming platforms.
This is Australia's most loved national team, and we are delighted to be sharing that across all the platforms. One of the exciting parts of partnering with Nine is the platforms, the scale and breadth of platforms to share our stories.
Nine has already signed a 10-year rights deal with the IOC to broadcast the Summer and Winter Olympic Games from Paris 2024 to Brisbane in 2032.